invited to enter into the golden sacrosanctum of our underground workings. We hope you'll enjoy shoveling the seams, niggling for nuggets, grabbing everything you can of that marvelous assumption which corrupts us all. One word of warning, any truth you find down this mine, you must sieve it very carefully for untruths. For that is the golden message of your trip down the gold mine. Well, this is special gold mine. You are welcome. Remember, be suspicious. Right, gold bunny.
Enter.
Suspicion is the moment you have been waiting for.
Seats for everyone.
Have a seat. What is the truth here, gold bunny? To tell the visitors?
There ain't no gold. There's no gold in this mine. There ain't no gold.
That's it. You don't have to come down here. You don't go down anything. Remember?
Come on, have a seat. The seats for everyone.
In this theatre?
Notice how hopeful we can be if we move physically slowly, suggesting that the minds are racing. Wish to God mine was.
Here she comes. There is a great sense of
embarrassment about it all.
Yeah, have a seat, sir.
Said the girl, The branch of that tree is shaped like a high heel. The boy took out his saw and cut down the part of the tree. It looked exactly like a high-heeled shoe, but it was very primitive. He then took out his knife and hollowed it out like a dugout canoe, so that it nearly accommodated his lover's foot. But it was uncomfortable. Along came the Industrial Revolution, and the shoemakers turned to iron for making the soles of the shoes. They constructed a strong shoe. But it was clumsy. The use of timber was discontinued, and an improved all-steel shoe was fabricated. But it lacked refinement. Time passed until now, when contemporary designers have given us the magnificent high-heeled shoe we see here. A wonderful tribute to ladies' feet everywhere. But it causes bunions. You see, high heels demonstrate a delightful lie, which is in the process of being found out, shall we say, teetering to extinction. They survive for very good erotic reasons to satisfy the oglers of our civilization. But livers and pedicures are working on this, and the happy days of foot fetishism are numbered. The teaching of the parable of the high heels is, if we can fool ourselves with such minor absurdities, then how about the big leak? The moral, an incorrect assumption leads to a false conclusion. Right, Lord Bonnet? All together now, an incorrect assumption leads to a false conclusion. Oh, aren't they clever? And you will remember this. Never forget. That will be your guide. Now, to say free, to rummage amongst the workings for deliberate untruths, do help them to find a lie or two. I can tell you now your discovery will be that you discover untruths that you knew the truth about all the time. It's so friendly, such fun, discovering this way. And when you find truth, you must run up to me and tell me all about it. But I should warn you, I am ready for a lie or two. Oh, this is, of course, much better than, if you discover it yourself, much better than being told. I mean, wouldn't the 49ers have hated it? Damn it, how frustrated you would have been if some smart aleck had shown them precisely where to find the next nugget. Your discovery, when you make it, will be your own. You will get full credit for it. And so, quite naturally, you will cherish it. You will defend it. And we can now secretly believe and nurture all of our own inward lies. We can cook them nicely and bake them into little truth buns and then ram them down unbelievers' throats. I'm sorry, I possibly shouldn't have said that. Another advantage in finding out for yourself, of course, is that I don't have to be your guide. Believe me, I'm in the dark too. And I am then spared the embarrassment of not being able to explain things even by telling lies. Believe me, I really am all for the quiet life. Ah, the thought of a quiet life promotes me to leave this gold mine. Damn it, you say, we've only entered the place. Ah, true, but we will only leave it in a journey of the mind. So tune in, ladies and gentlemen. Tune in to your mission control. Start counting yourself down. Count down and mentally blast yourself off. Blast off for an imagined trip to the moon. Let us now contemplate the wonder of planet Earth from afar. Thank you, old money. Okay.
Ah!
Now,
From this grand circle, the moon in space, we can see our energetic little friend, the sun. Look! It's switched on, bursting with ferns and nurturing us and on a dear old Earth, absolutely free of charge. Even the first men in the moon, of course, managed to wax poetic inside their gold foil spacesuits. They actually like the look of dear old Mother Earth, the place from whence they've come. It is the same, say, with gurus and mountaineers and those kind of airplane pilots used to wear goggles and leather leggings. Surprisingly, it is not so with dwellers in high flats. Maybe it's due to dodgy lifts, I don't know. But I must not destroy this high-flown observation, otherwise I'll get stuck between the floors. I mention this distant view of our Earth for two reasons. One is, we are often unkind to dear old Earth, and we shouldn't be. The other is to encourage us to think of ourselves as tutti individual energy cells, powered by what the sun, by way of the Earth, has given to us for our dinner today. Inside us it's bubbling away and generating the energy for us to make our scratch on the planet. But the main idea is simply to be objective, to stand well back from Earth and look at what we are doing to it. Oh, what confidence you have given me, dear Galileo. We will linger a while, therefore, on the moon and throw the time switch from past, present to past, and zoom in. Shall we zoom in on our long legs on the ancient Greek island of Delos? Arrive, if you will, at Delos, and I can tell you that the Greeks there, the ones I'm interested in, look like those radiations of the vases in the National Archaeological Museum. That such Greeks lived on Delos. And they thought a lot of their universe. And they thought of it with much more awe than we moderns do. They thought a very great deal of their sun. Of course, they had to think a lot of something, because in those days, you see, they didn't have TV to distract them by offering nearer and more trivial things to worship. Nor did they simply regard dear old King Saul as a reason for selling ice cream, Coca-Cola, or air conditioning. Ancient Greeks are definitely best. Modern Greeks, they watch a lot of television, and although the sun is very generous, they are still inclined to use it to help them sell a lot of things. Ancient Greeks had words for things. I tell you, no simata. Now, the ancient Greeks loved Delos, and they made of it a sacred island and a mission control for keeping in touch with their gods, who up there performed spectacular head-bumping acts against the background and backdrop of real thunder and lightning. On some occasions, sometimes a sheep. Sometimes a goat. Sometimes a sheep and or a goat would be sacrificially launched to sweeten the deities lurking in the upper stratosphere. On our Christian soldiers marching as to war with the cross of Jesus. See, these ancients were very pleased with that new universe, and they felt they just had to do something to show their appreciation. They did not realize that the great universal package which had been sold to them was under guarantee. And the whole thing would have worked quite naturally without the poor sheep and goats. Maybe, of course, it's simply that the tourists expected a ritual. Sheep and goats, you see, now began to run away when approached by humans. Their numbers dwindled. If these ancients had quite simply stuck to happy primitivism,
and used their ritual barbecues as a source for kebabs and souvlaki, the world would truly be a much better place. But no, the shrinking meat supply and the tendency just to go one better demanded that other things, quite unnecessary offerings be made, like precious things, like gold. The greatest ever confidence trick to be played on the human race by the human race was about to happen. An incorrect assumption leads to a false conclusion.
Of course, to walk with his legs
fairly wide apart, giving rise to the expression, gods move in mysterious ways. Now, the singing lions of Delos, another good act. Oh, a very impressive lineup amidst the temples, for each temple had its treasury, because gold had to be locked up when it wasn't being shown to your favorite god. Even at this early stage, mere mortals had sticky fingers and were beginning to believe that somehow or other they would be better off for just having some of that stuff. Unlike sheep and goats, it didn't have to be deep fried. And also, it satisfied the underwriters for getting ships past the Argonauts. It could also be neatly stacked. There was something fishy about the whole thing. And so, gold, that legitimate, lovely metal, useful for electrical contracts, I beg your pardon, useful for electrical contacts, spacemen's umbilical cords, fancy picture frames, and tiaras. It has seduced us from the moment it gleamed from among some ancient crack under the ground. And it seems, thank you, such a pity that we go to so much trouble to dig it out of the ground just to put it back down there. Early goldsmiths, they happily hammered it into a nice line in drinking cups and bangles, and my own personal favorite, those golden masks, which were, of course, mainly used for jollying up the royal corpses, a practice which, unfortunately, didn't quite make it to our civilization. Of course, gold teeth did, and so we became completely dazzled by it. Gold was now inextricably mixed in the depths of our pockets and our beliefs. The day of the slack abacus had arrived. For an incorrect assumption leads to a false conclusion. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the singing lines of Delos, let us have a golden sheep or goats, but chicken or peasants or bats or antelopes or aardvarks had fueled the source of sacrificial smoke. We became trapped in the net of our own network, and the ancient void was filled with tourists
and the garbage of archaeologists, mostly believing that it had supported a higher form of culture. All this was apparent, and proudly so, the sending up of praise could be ostentatiously obvious. Send up it certainly was, and is. The temple, now impressive, the bank, now respectable, blended into an unembarrassed oneness. Trestacles became the star of the roadshow. It's hard, however, to suppress primitive roots. And the avaricious game is given away by over-eager players noisily shadow-boxing in exclusive amphitheatres. The stance for this is the one with the foam jammed between the ear and the neck. And at the other end of the line, the rest of us play the part of the sheep or the goats. As a matter of great interest, whatever happened to usury? Like sheep and goats, gold became a bit thin in the ground. And so, with another out-of-tune fanfare, there entered the great magic troupe, the Alchemists. They were a sort of hubble-bubble, bunch of mystics who also got it entirely wrong. Is that not so, Galileo? Thank you. Every trick the alchemist tried went wrong, and yet this clumsy magic circle claimed to possess the secret of life itself. They were canny enough not to lose sight of the goal they had in mind. But this, of course, is quite easy because they never produced any to lose sight of. But hark! From over the Alps comes a yodel signaling the arrival of Paracelsus, a Swiss scientist who certainly was not related to Trestacles. Paracelsus, like good old Galileo, got things right first time, and like a 16th century Superman, he swooped down to the alchemists and replaced all their abracadabras with chemistry. Yes, Paracelsus produced the very first chemistry set. And with it came a no-nonsense guarantee that it would work. And so it does, to this day. Oh, Paracelsus, you are one of the better influences from over the Alps. You freed the medicine men from the great bum steer of alchemy and gave them chemistry. Smile upon us. Free us from our financial wizards, who daily try to mesmerize us, yodel golden warnings to us all, and look again at the condition of the original Earth Guarantee. Get your copy of the Earth Guarantee. It is the natural Earth Guarantee, given away from the very beginning of the universe. Make sure you've got a copy, because if you haven't, you've lost your money. That's it. Just look at that guarantee. Now, we really did not need to tinker. We didn't need to tinker at all with gods and temples and sheep and goats and churches and treasuries and bomb steers. There is some excuse for the poor old ancients who put all together on behalf of their invented gods. We will never know if they were actually fooled by it. But we might, I think, ask ourselves if we are. Anything at all in the paper, gold bullet, I wonder what it says. But the sun, the real thing, it still shines. Thank you.
Politicians unite! Politicians night. The very words are embarrassed at being put together.
Economists!
Ha-ha.
The mystics, who are always ready to confuse us with a brand new set of permutations, but they, we have called on them before, and already, and again. There is interference in transmission from the sun, and they would like us all to think that normal service will be resumed as soon as possible. What? No sun? Then tell them to use an electric fire. Like a hearty excuse, it is admitted that economics is not an exact science. The exponents produce plans about as inexact as amateur patchwork. And if asked to make, say, a quilt, great variety and doubtful quality would certainly be assured. The crazy designs somehow protect them from ever being questioned. So who then will weave the great universal blanket which will evenly warm us all and not slip off the bed? Well, this particular energy cell is smart enough, or shall we say not yet smart enough, to come bouncing back with any slick remedies. But if we ask enough questions, perhaps one or two of you daytrippers will feel inclined to put something into our suggestion box. Try to do this before you find yourself being discarded, de-energized, in receivership, or having to think up some perverse ways to apply your scritch-scratch. Let's have a look, just do have a look if you will, at the small print in your original Earth Guarantee. I will quote from it for your benefit. The product has been made from the best materials available, unquote. But, quote, it is only guaranteed insofar as daft, which is of course a Scottish word, meaning reckless, foolish, brainless, or even crazy. It is only guaranteed insofar as daft things are not done to it or on it. Unquote. Ha-ha. Are daft things being done? We'll have a word with the service department, because Universal Creations left care and maintenance of this product known to Earth to us. Now there is a machine for distributing wealth. It is in fact operating so that each one of us gets a ticket for what the sun and the Buddha have done. Is everyone getting an equal opportunity? No! Why? That, if it doesn't work, turns suspiciously like a bolt to the start. And why? Damn it! Because of you, Tristagrees! Get it out! The great golden spanner dropped in the works. Dropped in the works by none other than Tristagrees, that ancient dab hand of going one better when it comes to cocking up the only part of the natural cycle the great manufacturer left to us to manage for ourselves. Yeah. And if you're still inclined to think that we must be a great deal smarter than Tristagrees, then spare a thought, buddy. Wall Street crash. Now do regard everything down this mine with the greatest suspicion, particularly if it seems at first to be as good as gold. Oh, do ignore the sun. Reject it as the energy source for all of us. Simply refuse to believe that physical energy, mental energy, and spiritual energy are contained in each one of us and have to be released by each one of us, otherwise the whole natural cycle chain gets broken. You are, of course, perfectly free to backpedal and believe reluctantly that the only true wealth capable of improving the human condition is ourselves. And ourselves, it seems to me, we have a lot to answer for. Better admit it, we are all into it. We've all got the habit. Oh, one dear man. calls Robinson Crusoe nearly broke the habit when he swam back to the wreck to salvage Mars bars and the iced Coca-Cola, which he then considered more essential than the doubloons. But on second thoughts, of course, he took away something else from him. And I have just torn his script. Come to the magic night, which I will hold too long. I quote from the original Pfeiffer, Robinson Crusoe. I went every day on board and brought away what I could get at low water. I went on board and I found about 36 pounds value in money, some Brazil, some pieces of eight, some gold, some silver. I then smiled to myself at the sight of this money. Oh, drunk, said I aloud, what art thou good for? Thou art not worth to me, no, not the taking from off the ground. One of these knives is worth all this heap of gold. Even remain where thou art, and go to the bottom as a creature whose life is not worth saving. However, upon second thoughts, I took it away. I do hope that this your little day down the gold mine is friendly too. I mean, it's the chummiest way that George and I could dream up to entice you to examine this suspicious proposition. Helped, no doubt, of course, by the seductive mention of the programme of gold. That is, of course, in bullion form. But excluding electrical contacts, special umbilical cords, picture frames, and tiaras. Perhaps the greatest bump steers and all our absurd rituals are indeed simply the intentions of the great universal creator. Perhaps the whole jing bang was designed by some cranky kinetic sculptor who as a believable combination of wonder, disorder, and total destruction, and that our tinkering is an intentional requirement for maintaining the whole rickety, energy-squandering thing. Well, me, of course, I could still be wrong, but unless you think I'm off. I am all for finding the end of the rainbow and taking a cake in the big crop of gold. I am not there. The suspicious contents of the file which I checked into him have given us the right attitude of mind for not knowing where I'm going. How about you, Jim? We can now maybe even have a shot at thinking beyond the future. The next past.
This will make black, white, foul, fair, wrong, right, base, noble, old, young, coward, valiant. Why, this gold will lug your priests and servants from your sides, pluck stout men's pillows from beneath their heads. This yellow slave will knit and break religions, bless the accurist, make the whore leprosy adored, place thieves. And give them title, knee, and approbation with senators on the bench. That is it that makes the wapened widow wed again. She whom the spittle house and ulcerous sores would cast a gorge at. This embalms and spices to the April day again. Come, damned earth, thou common whore of mankind, that puts at odds amongst the rout of nations, I will make thee do thy right nature.
Thank you, Timon of Athos.
Why Shakespeare?
As Timon of Athens knew, an incorrect assumption begets a false conclusion. But the sun, it shines.
You know, I just think,
on the surface, near the entrance to any self-respecting mind, there is always a slag heap. But given time, this barren hill will become green and more deserving of wonder than all the paved dirt now refined and neatly stacked underground, demonstrating the sterile absurdity of all modern primitivism. This confident regeneration will be performed free of charge by sun energy, earth energy, helped on occasion by human energy. Try to notice when this happens. And that it happens time and time and time again, despite ourselves. How do we eradicate a primitive and ancient influence whose false brilliance and power challenge even the sun? We might just stand a chance if we could get back to that whiter than white state of mind we had the day before we were born. We could pile ourselves into the front loader of the womb and have mission control catapult us back to where we were, wherever we were, before that. Or if you want to go one better, like Trestocles, who incidentally was also the god of detergents, we could even consider what we were before we were that. But out of the way, Trestocles, I'd like to be serious. Now that your minds have been crisped and finally battered with suspicion, you're about to be clattered with some simple but very serious truths. Think of it as just as if you were really in the mind was a sudden fall of rock. Well, the sun still shines. It energizes planet Earth. We, the humans, are energized through the Earth. Try to deny that. Each one of us is designed to release three energies: physical, mental, spiritual. The spiritual is not one whit less important than the others. All of these covered by the original Earth guarantee. Any situation which arises and denies any one of these three energies must be suspect. Now, I am sorry to trouble you over there again, but I would like to take one more look at our dear old planet Earth through that highly objective lunar telescope. Thank you. Now, we should look at something. Anything! Bishop is our name. We should look for anything which is suspect. Aha! Peek above. Could you clear my telescope, please? And there we are! Hello. What is that? There is something lurking behind three gold balls. It's corrupting us all. Terrestri, please! Yes, spy, come on out. We know you're a patron saint of money lenders. Mr. Hold on, wait! Shh! Yeah? Mission control. Oh, I think they're getting a border call. About to descend on us. Push it 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yes. No one should deny any human being their natural right to think or do and consequently feel. The free flow of creative energy from each of us is essential before we can function as complete human beings. This will lead to new ideas which will not comply with established thoughts, and so there is a requirement to accept difference. We must learn to compromise. Institutions must be questioned, and they will therefore change by compromise or be strengthened by a tested belief in the old. The money system, which controls controls the energies of each one of us, and whatever we organize is suspect. Primitive attitudes projected into our times, no matter what respect their permanence has given them, must be questioned.
Doesn't stop it from being the truth.
Down this mine, spade is called a spade.
And there is no reason why it should be called anything else. Right at the mine entrance, I warned you, be suspicious.
And if you'd been paying more attention then, you would have avoided that rock fall into your ears. An enrichment of our capacity to be suspicious and perform mind flips is the real pay dirt from a trip down this mine. We, the great human race, can surge forward if we can perform the monetary mind flip. Is it too much to expect any improvement in the condition of humanity until we do this? Or shall we just remain it forever in the dark, grumbling for gold, prolonging the greatest ever confidence trick perpetrated on the human race by the human race, ourselves? An incorrect assumption leads to a false conclusion. And is this the message that you should take from your little day down gold mine? The short answer, dear panhandlers, is yep. And if you ask me if I'm sorry or George is sorry about doing this, then the equally short answer is nope. We would like to stand up and be counted. We'd make a protest about power and energy, the misuse of yours, mine, and other people's. I complain of the web which blurs the definition of good and evil. I complain of our inability to mind flip, like good old Paracelsus and Galileo, and recognize untruth disguised as truth. I do complain of conditions done as mine. All the great bomb steers and the total absence of suspicion, our incapacity to invent ourselves as gods. I say that it is possible that God is really just a great bird. And to this great God we should build a temple. We should offer up to the great bird sunflower seeds and we mice. Frogs and Mars bars and drinks on sticks. If supplies ever run out, we can change to Mars bars and Coca-Cola. They all stack neatly. Well, we are off now to mind flip with the Caramac shops. We could, just as a last gesture, we could complete the rainbow. Tell us. Ready? Ha! Rest, please. Why are you clutching your groin?